नमस्कार। टुडे वी आर मीटिंग फॉर थर्ड सेशन ऑन एजुकेशन अबाउट योगा। द बेसिक प्रॉब्लम दैट यू विल फेस इज दैट वी हैव बीन इंडॉक्ट्रिनेटेड दैट योगा इज अ प्रैक्टिकल सब्जेक्ट एंड वी हैव गॉन ओवरबोर्ड थिंकिंग दैट इट इज एक्टिविटी एंड it is something to be performed, it is something to be done. But I want to introduce to this a unique perspective that there is a lot of education in yoga. We need to know something before we do something. There are two ways. One, you can do and then learn. There are certain realms of knowledge where you do and learn. But then there is something like learn and then do. Now in this education, it is important that we try to know something about yoga and then see how we go about doing it. As I've been stressing on the distinction between posture and anasana, so let me say at the outset that the postures commence with biomechanics and the postures culminate with biomechanics. So through and through there are biomechanics in postures. Then where does yoga come in postures? The postures are necessary. We must learn the posture. It has to be a workable posture, proper posture, good posture. And through such posture, we need to learn yoga. Now, let me illustrate this. Now, you can set it out in Virasana. So, if it is a posture, how will we go about? Keep your feet turned out properly. Rotate your calf muscle inside out. Rotate your thigh muscle outside in. And then sit properly. Sit straight. Sacrum concave. Open your chest. Lift your spine, shoulders back. And through we'll be just telling you about the biomechanics with reference to different parts of the body. So maybe the arm positions can come. Arms, back, namaskar at the back. Parvatasana arms over the head. Gomukhasana arms at the back. Or Garudasana arms in front. So you can be doing all these postural variations. So you can do that in a posture. Gomukhasana arms, Namaskarasana arms at the back, Parshva Namaskarasana, or Gomukhasana arms. Now we will be telling you about skeletomuscular parts of the body, their action, what should go down, what should go up, what should rotate, what should be stretched, what should be straightened, what should be hardened, what should be softened. Like elate the pelvis, elate the diaphragm, lift your chest, roll the shoulders back, shoulder blades in, dorsal back in. So these are all biomechanics. So it commences with biomechanics and it also ends with biomechanics. So the posture is like a starter for a vehicle. Once you start your vehicle, you don't dabble with the starter time and again. So similarly, the posture is like a starter. And then we have to see that we proceed for an asanic condition. Now, if it is an asanic condition, now let's try to understand the implications and nuances. The body, mind, breath, awareness, as I taught you, told you about in the first round, first session. Now, in your Virasana, there are paradigms. You can do the Virasana, which can be called as hip buttock sacroiliac Virasana. So that's the porthole from where you will try to negotiate your Virasana. So find out how do you do it? Where there should be launch point at the sacroiliac region, sacrum, tailbone, coccyx, hips, buttocks, anal mouth, pelvic region, on the anterior, below the navel, pelvic floor to navel, abdomen. So this is how, with this paradigm, we'll be going about. Now that can be changed to shoulder blade. It can be shoulder blade measure, Virasana. So find out how you modify the dynamics, how do you reset the dynamics between buttock bone, sacrum, centricity to shoulder blade centricity. Then from shoulder blade centricity to chest centricity, diaphragm centricity, abdomen centricity. So you will have various negotiations possible. Like you drive a car, you don't just start a car, you drive a car. So you'll be driving the asanas. There are different schemes to drive an asana based on paradigms in asanas, in yogasanas, which doesn't come in posture. Posture, it is a general addressal to entire body, skeletomuscular physical body. Now in your Supta Virasana, you can be doing, or your Virasana, sitting Virasana, you can be doing the Virasana as an exercise condition. Skeletomuscular exercise. Find out how you can exercise skeletomuscular body by your Virasana, which can be with Parshvanamaskarasana, Gomukhasana, Garudasana, arms in the front, Parvatasana, arms over the head. So these are all probabilities where you will activate the body differently, and that's how it becomes physical culture. Now, in yogasanas, you have to identify how you are not only doing the skeletomuscular movement, but how you can use a profound breath, a profound inhalation, a profound exhalation, voluminous exhalation, voluminous inhalation, sharper inhalation, thicker inhalation. So also sometimes the post-exhalative retention, Uddiyana Kriya, Uddiyana Mudra can come. So you will make the negotiations more profound by applying the breath on your skeletomuscular body. So also you can apply your mind on your skeletomuscular body, which will significantly contribute, such as by will, by volition, by resoluteness. If you are going to exercise the body, you require a typical mind culture to be exercising skeletomuscular body. So you can use that aspect of mind, the intent to exercise skeletomuscular physical body. So find out how the breath will contribute, the mind will contribute. In an associated condition, how it will contribute. Now, if you do this much and this way, it will again be a physical culture. You are using the body, mind, breath for the benefit of the body. You are using the body, mind, breath combinations for skeletomuscular physical body. So again, it will be physical culture. In yoga, we need to go beyond physical culture. If it is yogasana, it needs to go beyond physical culture, not just get stuck at physical structure or physical culture rather. Now, in yogasana, now find out how we will get different perspectives. Now you are doing Virasana, let's say Parvatasana arms. You are running Parvatasana arms, interlocking the fingers over the head, and then trimming the arms, straightening the elbows, extending the armpit, etc. Now, we are used to doing this for the body, for the corporeal body, for the skeletomuscular body, for the body matter. Now, use that position and start addressing your breath, making the breath as a beneficiary rather than a benefactor, which was in the earlier phase. Now, find out how you can be using the voluntary breath, the deeper breath, and give benefits to breath by Virasana chest, by Virasana back, by Virasana spine, by Virasana abdomen, by Virasana pelvis, by Virasana hips, buttocks, ilium, perineum. So the breath should be a significant beneficiary, which, as I said, is the breath set addressal. Similarly, you can do for your mind. Objectify your mind, understand the state of mind. Like if usually we are used to doing a photogenic pose. So we are camera conscious, lens conscious. We know what the lens catches, what the camera catches, and therefore we justify that position to justify camera lens. That's called photogenicity. Now imagine that there is a instrumentation to monitor your breath, whether you are activating the breath, whether you are giving benefit to breath, whether the breath is a beneficiary, exhalatively, inhalatively, how the breath is beneficiary by this Parvatasana Virasana. In another pose, it will be different benefit to the breath. So not only use the breath, but also make applications on the breath. This is implied in an asana. Similarly, your mindset. Imagine that there is an instrument which is catching your brain waves, alpha, beta, gamma rays of your brain, the brain functioning as if there is an encephalogram going on, monitoring the functions of the brain, monitoring the benefits to the brain. So we can use the brain and we can give benefit to the state of the brain as well by yogasana. In posture, it doesn't happen. It is not considered so much. But in asana, you can give the benefit to brain as if there is an encephalogram, there is a brain scan going on, somebody monitoring your brain, monitoring as to how the brain is getting an advantage. So these are body, mind, breath addressable. Now today let me introduce a new dimension here. What is this new dimension? Usually you are familiar with a condition, you say, I am doing Virasana. What is the syntax? I am doing Virasana. Try to understand the noun, verb, predicate in the syntax. Now if I suggest, go for a condition where the syntax will be, I am doer of Virasana. What changes are you going to effect between I am doing Virasana, I am doer of Virasana? Are you really doer at a point in time? Another point in time, are you doing Virasana? I am doing Virasana has two meanings which we overlook. The sentence has two meanings. One meaning is with a tone that you are the doer, you are executor. You are playing executor role and you are executing Virasana. So you become doer. So there is a shade to the meaning of the statement I am doing, of the nature of I am doer. Your will, your subjective entity, your volition, your intent, your perceptions, your sensations. So you are doer of Virasana. The another meaning to the syntax is that you are instrument. You can be instrument when you say I am doing Virasana, you can be instrument of accomplishing Virasana, executing Virasana. So if you play instrumental role, find out how are the dynamics. If you are playing subjective role, find out how are the dynamics. Then there is a third syntax which says, I am being done. I am being done. So Virasana is being done on me. So subjective entity is sculpted, is carved, is cultured. So you'll have to render these syntaxes and understand the dynamics of it. I am doer of Virasana. I am doing Virasana. And I am done by Virasana. When I say I am done, I am not referring to tense. It is not past tense. So the done here comes as a noun. I am done entity. Virasana is a tool. Virasana is an instrument. Virasana is an object. And I am the beneficiary of it. My subjective entity is beneficiary out of it.
So you'll have to render these state syntaxes and try to understand the differences in negotiations. Now this is implied in an asana. Now if you are subjective entity, I am doer. Understand again the shades and nuances here. You can be doer when you identify yourself with your body. That you are body, you are corporeal body, you identify yourself with the body and then you say, I am doer. How do you go about? Then identify yourself with your breathing as if you are breathing, you are breath entity, you are identifying yourself with the breath. Understand how the negotiations will change. Thirdly, identify yourself with your own mind. I am mind. If I am mind, what do I consider? So you'll have three different considerations. I am body. What will I consider? I am breath. What will I consider? I am mind. What will I consider? Now, these are nuances of yogasana. These are not nuances of a posture. Because in posture, you will identify yourself with a body. You will say, I am straight. Actually, body is straight. I am firm. Actually, body is firm. So in postures, when you identify yourself with a body, understand the corporeal influence and gravity. But when you identify yourself with the breath, it will be different negotiation. So get your education here. How the negotiations change, how the considerations change. As a student of yoga, you must be able to identify yourself not only with the body, but with the breath and with the mind. Then I am doer of my virasana is antithesis of yoga. You are supposed to be a beneficiary. Subjective entity must be sculpted and carved. If you are doer, you are involved in activity of it. And you will never get the witnessivity. In yoga, you are supposed to be witnessing. Therefore, the other day I told you, allow the interaction of body, mind and breath and keep watching interactions. Then you will be soon getting onto the track of witnessing phenomenon in asanas. This is very important fabric of an asana, that you are not a doer. You are not even doing. You are not even done. You are witness. If you are doer, doing, done, it is a materialistic culture. If you are witness of the phenomenon of body, mind, breath interacting with each other, then you get the witnessivity. And that will be more closer to the core aspects of yoga. So I want to first help you overcome certain misunderstandings about yoga as asanas or postures. We don't really see distinction between the two. Posture is asana, asana is posture for us. But that is not true. Get this education, then you will know what are the dynamics of asanas. Similarly, there is a misconception about yamas and niyamas, on which I am going to touch in the next session. Yamas and niyamas are considered as moral, ethical practices. When in the scheme of Patanjali, when it comes yamas and niyamas, they are not moral, ethical practices. They are not moral, ethical principles. They are called ethico-religious principles. This needs a disillusionment, because most of us believe that these are moral, ethical principles, which are not. This I reserve it for the next session. What are yamas and niyamas? Why they are not moral, ethical practices? Why they are not moral, ethical principles? So thank you for your patience. Namaskar.